welcome to this forum, and ini acara yang santai. Jadi selamat pagi, terima kasih Pak Kadep Departemen Sejarah, Pak Dr. Abdul Wahid. Acara santai, jadi gak ada MC, pokoknya semuanya jalan dengan apa aja. Kita pagi ini kedatangan tamu dari Belanda, Hans Visser, Bapak Hans Visser, yang meneliti mengenai Swastika Yogyakarta dan kita dengarkan. Terima kasih kepada yang sudah hadir semua, mahasiswa dan teman-teman semua. Juga kita berbagi hari ini, ada yang bersama kita adalah Mbak Dewi Widya Suti, yang merupakan cucu dari Swasi. Nanti Mbak Dewi akan menyampaikan pesan. Baik, kita mulai langsung acara ini disiarkan melalui YouTube Departemen Sejarah. Sama-sama kita mohonkan sambutan Bapak Ketua Departemen, Bapak Abdul Wahid. Monggo, Pak.
Terima kasih Pak Agus. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Selamat pagi, salam sejahtera untuk kita semua. Good morning, Hans. First of all, I'd like to welcome Hans Visser to our Department of History. Welcome. Okay. Thank you so much for being here and for sharing your research with us, with all the students here. So we are really thankful. I think this is a really good opportunity for us here to learn, but also to know more Ibu Suwarsi Joyo Puspito, who is actually a very important figure. He is the wife of Supondo Joyo Puspito, one of the figure behind the Youth Pledge 1928, Sumpah Pemuda 1928. And she's also sister of Suwarni Pringgul Digdo, one of the prominent women activists back in the 1930s. So Ibu Suwarsi is a writer, novel writer, and one of the, her novel is about Gril, that is in Dutch, of course, and the Indonesian translation is Manusia Bebas, published by Jambatan. So I think that's one of her novel, but she also has other works, other novels, which really show her, you know, position, important position, and also role in the Indonesian writers, of course, Indonesian literature. And we can really see, and we have a small chat before with Hans, which is actually enlightening me as myself personally, that the importance of Ibu Suwarsi, because she is one of the women voice, so to say, voicing out the women perspective in the late colonial period, but also later in early post-colonial Indonesia. And that's make her, you know, her position is very unique and very important. So we are really glad to have you, Hans, here. Maybe you can tell more about Ibu Suwarsi later on, and we can have discussion afterward. So, teman-teman, ini kesempatan yang baik untuk kita belajar bersama, mendengarkan dari Hans. Ini bagian, this is part of your research, right? And then maybe you can come out as a biography of Ibu Suwarsi and Ibu Suwito. And as you might know, that this is a regular program that Department of History organize every month, actually, maybe even. We will have another one in the coming 2 weeks, in the next 2 weeks. It's a friend, I don't really remember his full name, but he's a journalist living in Indonesia from in the 1990s, and he was one of the foreign journalists who were there in the presidential house when Suharto stepped down as a president in 1998. So he will be here in 2 weeks' time, and he will tell the story, of course, about, you know, her journalistic activities during that period, which is a very important turning point in the political history of Indonesia, modern Indonesia today. So yeah, but I don't want to take more time. Hans, again, once again, thank you so much for being here with us and for sharing us. And thank you also, Paulus, for convening this event and also in having Mr. Hans take it our department. So thank you so much. Selamat mendengarkan, selamat mengikuti. Dari saya sekian. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
I'm just sitting here, okay? Oh, yes. Next is Mbak Dewi will present some books that is the novel by Suwarse Djopuspito to the History Department of UGM. Please, Mbak Wahid, take your position here. this is Mbak Dewi yesterday. She is
Semoga buku ini bisa bermanfaat dan bisa menambah wawasan kita tentang perjuangan beliau, Bu Suwarse, yang cukup sedih sebenarnya kalau di Indonesia melihat tidak terlalu banyak orang yang mengenal beliau, dan beliau lebih terkenalnya malah di Belanda. Tapi dengan bantuan Hans Switzer, semoga bisa menjadi semakin dikenal.
Terima kasih tentu dari kami Departemen Sejarah atas pemberian buku ini. Ini akan menjadi bagian dari koleksi perpustakaan kami. Jadi nanti teman-teman mahasiswa yang tertarik bisa membacanya di perpustakaan. Mungkin ada dua. Saya mungkin juga nanti akan memberikan satu ke perpustakaan fakultas supaya tidak hanya Departemen Sejarah yang ini, tapi juga fakultas yang lain. Dan dengan demikian, ya, semoga semakin banyak mahasiswa yang kenal beliau. Terima kasih, Mbak Dewi.
Yeah, because the publisher of the novel, the Indonesian person, is supposed to be Mr. Jembatan. But we have actually copies from the copy centers, and I'm sorry, because this person has been also distributed quite much around us students here, right? And, but well, this is, of course, thank you very much for this. And for you all present here in this room, don't worry, but they will provide you with a door prize, okay, of the novel. There will be two door prizes for those who are present here in the end of this discussion.
Okay.
So, yes, okay. Thank you. So, well, let's start with the presentations of Hans Fischer. Hans Fischer is a journalist based in the town of the city of Alkmaar in North Poland. He was a journalist of, well, principally of North Poland's Dagblad. Do I pronounce it correctly? Yes. And some other newspapers in the Netherlands for the many years, maybe more than 30 years that you 40 years of journalism, okay? And he's now also in a committee for the so-called, what is it, the Krach, eh? A Little Krach concert, which is held every I think, of summer in Alkmaar. So this is quite a nice cultural activity in Alkmaar every summer. In addition to the Cheese Mother of Alkmaar. Okay? Alkmaar is very known for cheese, you know that, and also for Winmodern, and it's very beautiful. Sorry?
Food
and also food daughter of this Alkmaar agenda. So, without further ado, please hands your time, and then I'll see you. Okay?
I can push this one.
Yes, please.
Well, selamat pagi. Good morning, everybody. It's wonderful to see you all, and also that many people. I thought that I came here for a holiday, but I'm doing something more interesting than that, because I've got a story for you. I hope that I can tell you something new, and I guess. Why was he doing a hospital? Well, it was in the 80s, I think 1986, that I attended a lecture by the Dutch writer Rob Nieuwenhuis. He was talking about Suwashi Hospito, about the release of a new version of the novel Buiten het Gareel, Menusha Bebas. And what was interesting, he quoted a story that she wrote about her visit to Holland in 1953. It was almost in my hometown. And she visited there a cemetery. And she visited the grave of a Dutch writer, Eddie de Bellon. And she was there, and she was talking to that grave. And she said, "Eddie, where are you?" And then she heard his voice. She writes, "Of course, I'm with you in Indonesia, not in this Dutch earth." And that was for me already a fascinating quote. Later, a few months later, I met somebody here in Jogja, and that woman turned out to be later on my wife. And I found out that she was a granddaughter of Suwashi. And that's in fact how my journey started to Suwashi Dewey Hospital. Well, I give you a little bit more background. Yes, let's go to the next one. Yes, here we are. Here we see the background. These are the parents of Suwashi. On the left you see Jo van Pauw and his wife. In fact, they were the grandparents, and they were a Chinese couple, but they had a moment that they chose for the Islam, because he was very grateful to a change in their lives. There was some illness, and that was solved by their belief. One of the daughters you see down there, the daughters, and it is the second from the right, is Nisiti Hatija, and she was 16 when she married to Jojo Saputro, that is the man you see right, and that's her father, and he had already some marriage before. He was a remarkable man. His ancestors are the sultans of Cheribon. They were also fighting in the army of Diponegoro, and they settled in the west of Java near Bogor, the village Cibatok, and that's where Suwashi is born. He was a man who was a great storyteller. He was very good in Wayang stories. He was a Dalang. He was also very good in reading the Al-Quran. He could explain the book very well. And when he died, thousands of people came to the funeral, and they wanted to thank him for what he did for the people. At the other hand, he was not a very good businessman. So that gave some problems to the family, but he had the feeling that I have to do something for my children. He wanted that I should have a very good education. And and not only that, also a number of nephews, he succeeded to bring them all to a proper school, which was in fact remarkable at the time because not all the Indonesian children, as you know, had the possibility to go to a Dutch school. Well, to keep the story not too long, here you see Suharni and Suharsi. Suharsi was born, as you see on the right, she was born in 1912. Her sister Suharni is a few years older, and they went to the Kartini school. The Kartini school in Buitenzorg at the time in Boba was quite new. It was an idea of the Van Deventer, a Dutch politician, and they wanted that there should be more done for the Indonesian people, especially the Indonesian children. Well, at that school, she was really living there together with her sister. And in the first time, the first days, it was a little bit difficult, but. Suharsi wrote later on in her memories something about her. I put that quote on the picture. Can you read it? I hope it's proper Indonesian. So she, and it is what she writes about her is very nice. It is, in fact, she was, imagine, she grew up in a Sundanese world, Sundanese language. And then she goes to a school where she had to learn Dutch, with Dutch habits and everything. In fact, the complete Dutch culture, also with music, with literature, with everything. And that was for her in the first time very difficult. But she started to feel very well with that. Later on. Later on, she went to after that school. She grew up in Warsaw, and then she went to the MUBO, which is a high school at the time. And because she was a very good pupil, she could go to the Rijksbuurkweek school. It is an academy for to become a teacher, and that's what she should be. And that's what she should be. And in that period, she met her husband, later husband. But she was, by the way, the school, the Kweek school, where she became a teacher, was in Surabaya. And in Surabaya, something interesting happened, because there she met a Dutch teacher, who let her, she started to write her first stories. And imagine it was a class with almost only Dutch children, Dutch students. Only two of them were Indonesian, she and an Indonesian boy. And it was maybe remarkable that her short stories, her essays were in fact the best of the class. And the Dutch teacher took her as an example, also her stories. There was nothing, it was something besides that. He also started to read in that school the book, the novel Max Havelaar, written by Mulder Tudy. And I think that maybe I have to explain a little bit. The story of Max Havelaar is the story of an assistant resident in Lebak, who finds there a lot of situations which are not very nice, very difficult situations. There is the regent, that means the Indonesian ruler there. He is not taking care well of his people. And that story is very important for her, but that story would follow her whole life. And also an inspiration, and not only for her. If you go to other people of the who's of pretty important part in the Indonesian nationalist movement, they are almost inspired also by this novel. So after all, at that period, she also understood I have to do something for my people, and especially to help the education of women. And that is what she should go to do in the first place. After all, that she became a teacher, and that is the time that she went to the what we call the wild schools. Wild schools means that they were not supported by the colonial government, but just by the goodwill of the parents of the children and what the teachers by themselves. It means that these people were not rich. At that time, she met. And we see here a picture of 1928 with his sister on the right, and the other woman at the left is an assistant of Kartini. He went with them as an assistant to take care of them when they went to a women's conference in Delhi, India. But more important that year for Indonesia was the second meeting of the youth in Jakarta at the time. It was still Batavia. And he was the chairman who led it to the Sumpah Pemuda. As you know, it's the appointment of how Indonesia should be in the future. Independent with their own national hymn and with the old national language, and that was his role. What happened there, for instance, was also that for the first time the national hymn was performed. It was Rudolf Brockmann who wrote the music. But it was not. They were not allowed to perform that at the Congress. But there was somebody of the colonial government, and he negotiated with Sukarno, and that was allowed to play the music. They were not allowed to sing it, but they could play it anyway. You see, it was not an issue for the newspapers, because there you see on the right a small message in one of the newspapers, and in fact they only say that there was some trouble, but the police could solve that, and the Congress ended without any incidents. That's all you could read at the newspaper. After all, it turned out to be a more important meeting. Sugondo and Sumarsi, they married in 1932, and here you have a picture that is made just before the wedding. He received Sugandha together with his friends, and the group where they belonged to us was quite special, because they lived in Bandung, and her sister was there together with a lot of people who should play a role in the national movement. Among them, for instance, was Sultan Shahrir, and at that time, it is maybe rarely known, but at that time, her sister, Suwanu, was even engaged to him. But they broke at the moment that Shahrir had to leave for his study in Holland, first in Amsterdam, later on in Leiden. In her memories, you can read how much she was broken by that situation. She was very sad, Suwanu. But after you, there is a coming new biography of Shahrir, and I think we will read something more about that. But a friend of mine is working on that, and he has some amazing letters, and I could have already a few on that. How did it look like at such a school? Next one, please. Here we see Suhasi with her class in Bogor, the Tamil Sister School, 1933. And you see that is just a normal school class. I didn't know that, but my brother-in-law told me that the notes on the picture are written by Sugandha himself. That he said that was his habit to do that. And fortunately he did, so we know when this picture is taken and where it was. Can we have the next one, please? Yeah. This is the period in which she started to write. She was on school already, quite busy with reading essays, short stories. But in that time, she also started to write a novel, which is in amazing. In fact, she was about 20 years old, and she wrote a novel, Mariana. It's about a young woman who suffers in a marriage which the man is fooling around, and with all the problems that comes along with that. She wanted to publish the story, but the story was refused by a publisher, and that means that she was very disappointed. But first, I want to say something about this picture. I come back to that. What you see here, they were not really rich, but here you see, and that is such amazing, that must be a picture of my mother-in-law as a baby. And it is amazing when you read the book, the novel, Het Gareel, because you can read how she was born. It is amazing that you see how my mother-in-law was born. A very special experience. The advice of Sugandha was when she was having given the birth, you have to drink a lot of milk. That will help. I don't know if it works, but that's what I remember from the story. So you see that, in fact, the furniture was quite modern. The style of the furniture is what we call the Amsterdamse school. It's a design of very it's quite strict, and it is quite modern at the time. And then at that period, Then we come back to the amendment already added in Pearl, which has been a very important moment for them. Eddy de Baron was a Dutch writer born on West Java, and that you see as a young man, he is the picture is taken at that time. Later on, he went to Holland. He became a very important and leading writer, also because of his not really conservative opinions. He was quite progressive. And at a certain moment in the 30s, he came back to Indonesia, to Java. He wanted to find back his the country where he came from. And there he met a lot of people, Dutch people, but also Indonesian people, which was quite new for the time. He became a close friend of, and we can have the next one, yes? He became a very good friend of the family Pringle-Dingle. Suwarno married later on with Abdul Karim Pringle-Dingle. We know him as one of the people who negotiated in Holland after 45 about the Indonesian independence. But at that time he was still a civil servant in Jakarta. And he was, you see, they were quite close to each other. There are many more pictures of how they met each other. And the other picture that is also nice, the right picture, is that they are visiting the family Mangu Somo, Suyinno. He was also a very close friend of Jojo Pospito's. And you see a little girl sitting, and the little girl is now about 90 years old. She lives in Rotterdam. She was married with a Dutch doctor, and they used to work here in the Bethesda Hospital in Jogja. But I met her. It is still a wonderful woman. If you like nasi goreng, she can make it for you very well. She remembered that time that Dupont was visiting them, and she also told me that she was playing in the garden with the children of Suwasi and Suwando. Suwasi and Suwando get the advice: you have to meet Dupont. He might be interesting for you. But they didn't dare. They lived in Bandung at the time. They didn't dare because they had the feeling, yes, it is not done for Indonesian people to have friendships with Dutch people. After all, one day, Suwando was reading a book. Somebody knocked at the door. He opened the door, and there was a Dutch man together with his wife. The first feeling was, oh my God, this is the political intelligence. But it turned out to be Dupont and his wife. And from that moment on, there started a very close friendship. A friendship that should be very important for her development as a writer. Because there comes a moment that she was very disappointed about the publisher refused her novel, Mariana. That Mariana was written in Sudanese. And de Baron said, why are you so sad? You can write very well. Try to write another novel. Do something new. If you can write in Dutch, if it's you're very common with that language, write a new novel. And why don't you write about your experiences in the school, your life, because it is worth to tell the world what is your experience there, how heavy it is, how the struggle you have in that school to keep the school alive, to make money, to go on with that school, the children, and also the problems that you have with the political intelligence, because they were followed by the political intelligence. It was not wrong to have the wild schools, that was not a problem, but the problem was that they were afraid of there should be some nationalistic influence. And don't forget, at the time, it was that in the 30s, it was that Shahrir, Hatta, Sudan, they all got a lot of problems, and because they were very close to them, it was obvious that they should also have an eye on the Giorgio Pospito family. So, that's how she started to write Buiten het Gareel. Buiten het Gareel, and it's amazing that exactly 5 years ago I found this. This is a photo of the title script of the novel. So before it was published, this must be the original text of this novel. Of in fact, it's a kind of landmark, I think, in the Indonesian literature and even Indonesian history. What you see here, that is, you see in her own handwriting, you see on the left picture, Buiten het Gareel, and then on the top of the page, she writes the address in Bandung. And if you go to Google Maps, you will find the street is still there. It was a small street, and that is, she described it in one of the stories about her meetings with Duperon. On the right page, you see that Duperon gave some notes. He did also the correction of the novel, and he also gave some notes. He said, I gave some suggestions for the names of the chapters, but if you know something better, it's okay. I have found in the archive of Gerard Roshuizen, who is a Dutch researcher who was very well, he had a very good friendship with the family, and he told me how this worked. And the Baron has brought the manuscript to Holland, and there he found a publisher. That was in 1939. In 1939, it was in Europe already the Second World War started. And Holland was not involved, but in 1940, the book at least was published. Buiten het Gareel, you see here a picture of the book. And at the time in Indonesia, Suharsi, Sugondo, Rob Nieuwenhuis, and all those friends, they were writing in a magazine, Kritiek en Opbouw. It was a small magazine, but it had a lot of influence, and it was also very progressive. You see here the list of the people who wrote stories. And it is the number that is published in August 1940, and it is that was after that Duperon has died, because on the 10th of May 1940 Holland was captured by the German army, and a few days after that Duperon died because of a heart attack. You see right small news in the newspaper. By the way, it's the same newspaper that I work for much more later on. At that time, Kritiek en Opbouw, she published a number of articles. And one of the articles was, as I told you, in 1940, the German occupation of Holland started. And at that moment, she wrote an article in this magazine in which he said that is so sad. We really feel pity for the Dutch people that they are occupied now, but maybe we have to realize that Japan is coming, and we can expect that they will attack Indonesia too. Maybe if maybe it's a good idea to bring our Indonesian leaders back to Java, and she mentioned Hatta, Mangusomo, Syahrir, and Sukarno. And because if there are people, Indonesian people who can lead this population, these people here on Java and Sumatra, all the other islands, against the Japanese, then they should do that. Well, the result was that in Europe, we should say they get the yellow card. That's something that you get in football. So if you do something wrong and it is very serious, then you get the yellow card, and by the next failure, you are taken out of the game. So in this case, it means that buiten kritiek en opbouw get a very serious warning. One more article like that, and the magazine is cancelled. Well, that didn't happen, because already in the end of 41, the Japanese indeed came. After that, yeah, we got some heavy years of the Japanese occupation, and from 45, the independence struggle started. What can we find in the stories of Subasi about that? Well, in 1947, she wrote a letter to Befuik. Befuik was a very close friend of her, who also lived in Indonesia. She was Indo-European, but she made a choice for the Indonesian Republic. She wrote a letter in which she said, "I started to write a novel about my experiences in the last years, and I want to write about what is going on now." The story is never published. Why? Because there's an article in a Swedish newspaper in 1953 in which he says, "I'm working on a novel, but I can't do it anymore. I have to stop because it's too emotional. There's too much happened. I need time to reflect, and maybe I can do it later." But at the time, she already wrote a lot, and it is a pity that it never published, because for me it's a wonderful source of the life to get used a little bit to the life of Indonesian people before the Second World War, before the Japanese occupation. We almost learned something about what she did in the magazine Kritiek en Opbouw, with all those progressive people. There is also a wonderful scene, just like Buiten het Gareel, all the people really exist, but she gave them a different name. But so it is very easy to recognize also Syahrir, who was a very close friend of mine, but you also will recognize the people of the magazine. And then you see something interesting. She describes a meeting of three editors, three Dutch editors. One is the editor-in-chief, who will say, if there comes a moment that the colonial government and the Indonesian people will become each other enemy, then I will stand with the Indonesians. There is another man, that is Koets. He became later also one of the governors of Amsterdam, who said, "Well, in that case, I'm Dutch, so I will be on the Dutch side. And Dupont, he was there too. He said, in that case, I will be with my friends in the first place. So we get in that situation a nice view on how the people were thinking. The novel also gave a beautiful view of the normal life of people. For instance, that is she is always, everything she wrote in fact was autobiographical, and why do one of the proofs of that is that she describes a quarrel between her and her husband. He says, I want that if you are in the kitchen you use the trashy, because my mother used trashy, my father and my grandmother did it too, but it is not but she refuses that, and it's funny because my wife also doesn't like to use trashy. We are already with the next picture. But that it also, the novel also says something about, as I said, about the life of the people. You notice that you see the reaction of the people on the coming of the Japanese. And I think it's worth to have a look at this. That we also does is he opens with a wonderful scene, this novel. Of a trip by train in December 45, in which you feel the fear of the period. There is war going on. There is a fire in the background, and then the next chapter is kind of she wants to say, what am I doing? And it's kind of declaration of her position at that time. In the revolution, she believes. Don't forget that she is at the time that he belongs to the group of Shahir. She believes in a future in which they can have a lot of support of the Dutch government, in which didn't gain, of course. But she also explains why she is writing in Dutch and not in Indonesian. Well, that is very easy. Because she was used to write in Dutch. Then we can go to the next picture. Yes, this picture is made in Jogja, and in 19 December 48, it was made by the second attack, and it is an amazing picture. If you together with Agus, I have been watching this picture for a long time to see what is the faces. And in fact, you see Sugondo in the front row with the long trousers on the right. He belonged to the staff of Sukarno and the government. You see also Shirinji Hatta, and it was the moment that they were captured by the Dutch army and sent to Sumatra. It's quite an interesting picture, because you have a view on the who are these people, and seems that they are beaten, but after all, we should see that it was in fact the start of a glorious future, maybe. Let's go to the next picture. That's so, after all, in 1943, she gets the invitation to come to Europe. Dutch invitation, so she went to Holland. She traveled around there, but she also did She also went to Sweden and Ireland. By the way, to say there is a wonderful story, and that is so interesting in her life, that she is one of the very rare writers who gives the time of the revolution a female voice, and that is quite remarkable. I have read a lot of stories, but a female voice you don't see that very often. And now this day, 19 December, she wrote also a very beautiful short story. It's called Free as a Bird, Vrij als een Vogel. And it's about, the story starts early in the morning of the 19th December, 48. And she describes that there are planes flying over, and she thinks, yeah, what are they? What kinds of planes are these? What are they doing? What's going on? Her husband wakes up, and he goes to the office where he finds Sukarno. But she doesn't know what's going on. It's a story of the fear of a woman. She knows my husband is going somewhere where something is terrible is going on, but I know that. So in fact, you feel the fear, and it ends with an enormous flow of her tears, because all the stress is leaving her life and leaving her body. So now the next picture, please. Oh, no, another one with the news. Here you see, so she went to Sweden, and in Sweden she gave that interview with a newspaper, in which she explains that she couldn't finish that novel, but she had a lot of fun. You see, she is meeting a lot of other writers, and then she goes to Ireland for the Congress of the International Writers, the PEN. And in Ireland she also meets old friends. You see Abu Salim, Shahrir, and I think that, but I'm still working on that, she wanted to write a story about Ireland. She made already a start with it, but she made also several notes. It's still work in progress. But she was very interested in how Ireland was organized. But as I say, I have to work out that. And of course she went to Denmark, because that is the country of Hans Christian Andersen, the writer of a lot of fairy tales, and he, Andersen was her example. She admired him a lot. In this period, 56, 57, she wrote several stories for Confrontatie. Three beautiful novels, and I was surprised that they're quite serious novels. They all have the background of the revolution, but also, but it is in fact again the life of a woman. What is her experience at that time? What does she feel? What is the the husband is not at home, but she feels alone. There are three beautiful short stories about that period, but always, but even the feeling of a woman who feels alone, who feels what am I doing? I'm sad. Even women who are almost commit suicide. And one of the stories that also really happens. I wonder what is going on with her at the moment. Let's go to the next story, because that's something that I still have to point out. Here we have some pictures of her manuscripts.
then you see she is the one person that is coming back in honor stories after 45 is the person of Arlina. And she wrote Suffolk stories in which she is playing a main role. And always is there her background in Sudan, and always is there the revolution. But as I told you, that is what Gerard de Mos has also told me, everything she wrote is biographical. And is that true? Well, if you see, I just took a small element out of one of the manuscripts. You see that she is writing Aku, and then she changes it into Arlina. So in fact the story was very close to her, and maybe she almost forget that she was talking about and writing about somebody else to keep more distance to the story, to make it too emotional. But you see here several versions of that story. It's changing. Unfortunately, the story has never published. And after all, it seems to be the last version seems to be a mixture of the novel that she started to write during the revolution and a novel about her youth. After all, it goes together with the death of Shahrir in 1966. She belongs to the generation of who started the revolution, who started a new Indonesia. But it seems that she was very, and not only her, she was very disappointed in how it became. They had a dream, but it was not a dream that that came true. She lived in. And in fact, also, maybe you know the connection with Holland since 1957 was cut off, and it took too deep in the 60s that the connection with Holland came back. That means that also we see the comeback of her Dutch friends. They also saw Beb Fuik, Margrethe Verhoezon, Hella Hazen, and also Rob Nieuwenhuis, who was an old friend. He came back to Indonesia. And you see him here on this picture. And Rob Nieuwenhuis, she gave her a copy of her youth memories to Rob Nieuwenhuis to bring to Holland. See what you can do with it. But in fact, she was quite isolated. At that time, in Jakarta, the UI, Universitas Indonesia, they got also, again, Dutch department. And one of the people who started that department was Gerard de Moshuizen. You see him left on the picture. And he was, quite soon he went to Georgia to meet the family, and there he came quite often, and that was a very important moment for her. And by the way, you see on the picture Gerard, and next to him you see Suwasi Sugono on the right, and the first daughter in the middle. The left is you. And then the little girl, she became a little bit bigger, and she's sitting there. And the other girl, there with long hair, you have to wait a few weeks for that you can see her alive. That's my wife. And this was a very important moment for her, because at that moment she would talk about with him about her life, about her novel, and then the moment came that she got the invitation from the Dutch government, because that is what Gerard de Moshuizen did together with Professor. to make a translation of Buiten het Gareel. That became Minutia Pupas. At the there was already some years before an Asian writer, Jassim, was talking about translation of the title. He said Minutia Merdeka. But as he wrote to the Dutch government, that's the rough copy of the letters he wrote, in which he says, I don't want to call it Merdeka because that sounds too political. I want to Minutia Pupas. That's because I want that, it's because it goes, the story is about people with a free mind, free of everything. They people who make a choice for their own ideals, for their own future. And it seems that she said, I want to, yeah. For me it was a rebirth. I came back to my youth, to the time that I experienced, and I felt 30 years younger. I hope the translation is right. Yes, and as I told you, the connections with Holland came back. That also means that I show you already the picture of you from Haveling, the teacher at the Katini school. But it is the story about her is not fake. She really exists, because I found this in April. I found a letter that she wrote to Suwasi, in which she says that she has such a wonderful memories at the time, and indeed. She describes here from Aveling as she said, no, we also had so many teachers, but Juffrouw Aveling, in fact, she was so close to us. We felt that she was like a second mother for us. And unfortunately, the letter is a little bit damaged, but that is because somebody was collecting stamps. At the other hand, so it's exactly the place where I was there. Then, in 1976, she writes a story about the funeral of Shakir, which was 10 years before. It's a beautiful story in which she goes back to the period in Bandung, where she met her sister and all the other people. And it is a wonderful description of the spirit of the youth, but it ends with the funeral, and the funeral is it seems, I feel it like she is describing the funeral of the ideals of a period. It is maybe she didn't meant to do that, but I the style, the atmosphere in the story is like that. It's published in the magazine Tirade, which is at the time a leading literary magazine in Holland. Yes, and then we come to a story of which I don't know what it was. I found it somewhere between such a number of files. There is only page number 8, but I don't know to what story it belongs. But it's a story in which it describes that they live in 1949 in the Jalan Melati here in Jogja, and she describes how there is a Dutch action by the army, and the bullets are flying around, and they are. The fear is very high, and they don't know what's going on, and they they are not used to pray, but at that moment they pray. They put the children under the bed. Is this what we have to expect of the Dutch? Later, she starts thinking, and then he comes back. But not all the Dutch are like this, because we know De Perron, and then De Perron is coming back. He is as long as she lived, he was an example for her. For this, for instance, when he left, the last words when he left were, "It is in your life. Career is not important, but please be always an honest person." Honest to yourself, honest to the other people. Career is not the first. And then it ends, yeah, you can read it, what she says. That is nice. She believes in the future. And I think with this message, I would like to close this meeting. I hope that I told you something new and inspiring, and maybe in the future we can find more in the stories and inspiration, and maybe all those unpublished stories they can find their way to a new audience. I thank you very much. Three minutes.
Thank you, Hans. Very long talk, but we can understand several points very important on the personal life of Swazi on the one hand, but also how she thought about her relationship with some other Indonesian tokoh or nationalists, and how she saw the period after independence. Here in the last quote, seems that she saw a different tension of relations between the Netherlands and Indonesia and between generations of the two countries, and in which the older generations were burdened with the colonial past and the political trajectories that took afterward, but the newer generation started to engage, to get engaged to each other without a colonial burden or a burden of the past. And Hans also tried to sketch out some points from the novel Biden et Karel, in which Swazi herself was presenting her own experience as a nationalist, as a teacher of the Taman Siswa, but also some extent her disappointment. Kita tahu di tahun 1930-an banyak sekali tokoh nasionalis baru di dalam pergerakan Taman Siswa yang sebelumnya sebenarnya merupakan kader-kader kolonial di dalam masyarakat, di dalam struktur kolonial Eropa, yang kemudian karena krisis ekonomi tidak mendapatkan pekerjaan-pekerjaan yang seharusnya mereka dapatkan di dalam di dalam sektor ekonomi Eropa, dan Swazi mengungkapkan itu kurang lebih di dalam. But Hans also emphasized that Swazi wrote not only Baden and Karel. There are some other works, short stories and also novels. Some of them were not yet published, okay? But Hans found it in the piles, right? The archives of Swazi, which were actually in Mbak Dewi's house from time ago. And Mbak Dewi didn't know that it was harta karun for the story of Swazi. So remember, when you are asking questions, you will open a possibility to have to get the door prize, okay? There are two door prizes. Okay? Please raise questions. Yes. Wow, okay, so many questions. And Pak Wahid will give you a grade on which question is and you will deserve the prize, and also Hans will answer. Saya tadi melihat dulu.
Yes,
okay. Sabar, saya lupa. Nia, ya. Nia, silakan.
Thank you for the time given to me. My name is Nia. I'm a master student of Department of History UGM. Now, here I want to ask Mr. Fischer, about how was your struggle in collecting the archives in writing the history about Suharsidjo Yogyakarta, because we know that writing about Suharsidjo Yogyakarta is not only writing about a new nationalist figure but also a new women nationalist figure. So I'm so curious about how was your struggle? Is that difficult or no? I think it is harder than collecting the archives of other nationalist figures, and maybe it's enough. Thank you.
Terima kasih Mbak Nia. We'll collect the questions. Okay, and then 3 or 4. Okay, next. Yes, Mas, and then Mbak, and then Mas Tamim ya. Saya bukan Tamim.
Okay, thank you for the time, Mr. Hansuing and Mr. Hans Fischer. I'm Mandy from the Department of History. I want to ask some questions, but before I want to thank you, Mr. Hans, for the exceptional and really great insights from Suharsidjo Yogyakarta. When you mentioned about her unpublished stories and then the history of that she was once a teacher that can speak in Dutch and in Sundanese, some other language, and have strong relations with Dutch people. I want to confirm that, is that true that Suharsi got some dilemma or some concern about her identity, especially when her in her time at Indonesian independence or sometime before that or after that, because from her unpublished stories that you've mentioned before, because she mentioned that was too emotional to publish, and then after that when she wrote later after Indonesian independence, that she mentioned that it's hard to forget what has happened and what has happened to us, to Suharsi and Yogyakarta's family. Is there any citizenship issues that she had or her family has because she has strong relations with the Dutch?
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes. Next, another question, and then we'll answer. Yes. Mas Tamim.
Thank you.
Next. Thank you, Mas Nadia.
Okay. Thank you for the presentation, Mr. Hans. Actually, yeah, it's pretty good long question. So I actually write it down. Before that, my name is Tamim Agento. I'm from undergraduate student history department of UK. My question is, do you write down this presentation like it was somewhere like in a book or article? Because it is so interesting how you explaining and describing the life and the works of Suharsi. And actually, it's kind of embarrassing that the first time I knew Suharsi is from the art exhibition at Biennale, like 2 weeks ago. She's one of the forgotten reader, which being written in the book called Yang Terlupakan dan Dilupakan. It is a book consists of 10 women who being forgotten because of their affiliation with Sipil Kia and their affiliation with Lekra back in the 1965. But one thing that I want to highlight is we can reread and to dive into their minds. At this case, is Suharsi. we can reread and we can present the figure in an amusing ways, like an art exhibition, so we can introduce Swarcy into broader people and appreciating her works not only by the scholars but the whole society, and saw her as an important figure. Because I think her progressive works and thoughts is still bringing to this day her memory collective, her works, so we can reflect it and questioning, so her story can be told again and again. And also we can make a question like, is there a change in the society? Is the masculinity still dominating? And how about the women's voice and what's going on? Is it still same like a decade ago? And how it works like in a critic and oboe is still relevant to this day? That's it, the question. Thank you.
Okay, we're gonna take these three questions first.
Actually, I'm writing this three questions. Like, is it this presentation is being written down like in a books or something?
Yeah. So, type of questions is, I think, quite related to Nia's questions and how you struggle the research, archives, but also what is the output that you project to receive or to achieve in the a book or an article or
yes.
What's it? Please answer.
Well, in the first place, I would say that you come in a family with a wonderful story, and if you are like me, have a background as a storyteller, you want to do something more than just reading. Of course, you have to be lucky. I'm so very lucky that my sister-in-law still have a huge collection of papers that I can use. They are a real treasure. So you have to be lucky. I was also very lucky that I happened to meet in Holland Gerard de Boshuis, who gave me his archive with a lot of letters and manuscripts and all kinds of documents. You can even follow the whole translation of Bijbel met Gareel into Minutia de Bosch. But what I want to do in the future is when I have the feeling that I have enough, and also I have enough feedback also from Indonesia, is that I'm going to write a biography. And that is what Gerard de Boshuis asked me. He said, it is time that there's coming a book about her.
And Tom van den Bergen.
Tom van den Bergen, I knew him already a long time, and I remembered that we were talking once about Swarcy, and this spring, I think it was March or April, I contacted him and said, do you still have some information about her? He said, oh yes, I'm going to be retired, so please come here, I have a lot. And I get a new box with papers and manuscripts and even a Dutch translation of the Sunanese novel Mariana, and it is a kind of mistake that not in many publications, for instance, you see that Buiten het Gareel was written. It's a translation of Mariana, but it isn't. It is a complete different novel. And even Professor Theo and all this kind of, they all believe it is Buiten het Gareel is the Dutch translation of Mariana, but it isn't. It's a complete different novel. And there are, as I told you, I found so many stories, some published and some not. But I think, for instance, the unpublished stories, they are a real source also for historians to experience a little bit more of what happened at that time. And what is interesting in history, it is you learn something about what happened, but you can translate it to your own life, to this time. You have to learn something from history, and I think one of the things that I learned, for instance, is that you get involved with the life of somebody, And then you see that you recognize so much. It means that, of course, Holland and Indonesia, there is thousands of kilometers distance. But at the end, the emotions are in fact the same. That if people are glad, they are glad. If they are happy, they are happy. If they are sad, if they have pain, it's the same. I recognize so much in her stories. And that is also very amazing.
But do you have emotional boundaries? Because somehow you also have a familiar relations with the people you are researching. How would you negotiate between these?
What do you mean?
So you are a researcher, also a journalist,
yeah,
with the eyes of clinical reviews of the stories. On the other hand, you have also somehow closeness in the sources.
No, as I told you, I'm in the first place I'm a storyteller, and I don't want to write an abstract story. Of course, the facts are the facts, but I think that if you want to reach an audience, and I mean a common audience, then you have to find a style, a frame that is easy to understand. And it is a story about emotions, about personal feelings. And I think that makes it worth to do, and it is, I hope it can be interesting for Indonesia. I hope that I can get some feedback, because I'm writing from personal, I can't help it, Dutch point of view, of course. But I also hope that that I get some Indonesian feedback. And I live already more than 40 years with Indonesian influences, so I hope I understand a little bit more.
Okay.
You know my friend.
Yes, I do. And the question was whether the Eswatzi also experienced kind of citizenship dilemma, because she was originally from the Sunanis and Chinese background, and being educated in Dutch style, Dutch colonial life. And then she had to live in the Indonesian alam Merdeka, which was quite different. So do you think she experienced sort of a citizenship dilemma?
No. Well, I say no, because I have the feeling, and maybe I'm wrong, but I have the feeling, and I know her granddaughter, she is following very much her own way. She is very aware of what she is, and she, as far as I know her, not only from what she wrote, but also from the stories that I get from my wife and the whole family, is that she made her own choices. She had her own style, which is a mixture. If I, for instance, I met, let's say, 20 years ago, one of the daughters of Agus Salim. Of course, Suwazi died in 77, but when I, she was also a friend of that she also belonged to the group. But when I was talking to her, I was surprised by the very personal, the very strong own way of thinking. Yes, of course, if you read her stories, then you see that she is very, till the end of her life, she was very connected to her Sudanese background. The Chinese background, I think you find it in the kitchen, because that is also, my wife knows exactly what is a good Chinese restaurant and what is not a good Chinese restaurant. So it is still there, and it is, of course, by the years it will be becoming more and more a thing, but it's always there. But I think she never lost the background. She was always stoking. For instance, Donnie, your brother told me that She was a very good friend of the wife of Afandi, for instance. Why? Well, they had a very strong connection because both came from the Sudan country, and they could talk Sudanese with each other. Gerard van Moshuis visited her with a friend, and she was from also from West Java. So they had a lot of fun because they could speak Sudanese. It was always there. If you I also found out that she, in fact, she was not really happy in Georgia because she had a problem with the Japanese culture that was a little bit too dark. She was more she felt more home in the atmosphere of Sudan. She came from the neighborhood of Bogor, which is higher, which is it has a different climate and different flowers, different trees, different everything. So she wanted to, in fact, she always wanted to go back to that place. That's what you can write in the stories.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Hans. Jadi ini sedang menulis buku sebenarnya, dan koleksi Hans yang dipakai itu adalah arsip-arsip dari koleksi keluarganya Mbak Dewi itu. Di rumahnya di Kota Baru. Kalau di dekat gereja Kota Baru, kalau malam ada apa namanya mantap Bandung ya. Pokoknya dekat situ. Tandanya ada. Nah, tetapi suatu kali, rencana itu buat experience it. Suatu kali Hans ini memberikan presentasi di perpustakaan Leiden. Lalu ketemulah Tom dan Hanenbergen. Lalu Tom bilang, saya punya satu apa dus itu arsipnya Swarse. Lalu tapi saya nggak punya waktu nulis, sudah bawalah. Nah, jadi si Hans merasa mendapatkan tambahan harta karun untuk menulis mengenai Swarse. Saya bertanya-tanya bagaimana mungkin arsip keluarganya Swarse bisa ada di tangan Tom Vanderberger. Ternyata itu panjang ceritanya, sudah melalui beberapa peneliti yang lain. Tapi akhirnya kembali ke keluarga. Hans adalah kakak iparnya Mbak Dewi. Jadi Hans ini suami dari Mbak Kuit namanya. Itu kakaknya Mbak Dewi yang tinggal di Almar ya. Sehingga ada, memang ada keluarga. Tapi kalau kita perhatikan, Swarse Djo Puspito adalah adiknya Suwarni Prigodigdo. Ya, Suwarni Prigodigdo kita tahu istrinya Atta Prigodigdo. Nah, Suwarni Prigodigdo adalah aktivis perempuan. Ya, dan mungkin agak pribadi kata si Han, Suwarni Prigodigdo dulunya adalah sudah engaged dengan Sultan Sahrir. Sebelum Sultan Sahrir pergi ke Belanda untuk studi, ya. Kemudian mendapatkan istri Belanda, gitu. Tapi sudah engaged. Jadi kita lihat, nah sementara Swarse adalah istri dari Sugondo. Nah kita lihat bahwa di saat itu jaringan para nasionalis, intelektual nasionalis Indonesia itu sangat kuat. Tidak hanya dari segi pemikiran, tapi juga secara sosial. Ini yang menarik, yang dulu saya kira pernah akan diteliti atau sudah ya Mas Fahid ya, oleh si Sherman Tinker, gitu, dengan apa komputasi, gitu ya. Ini akan menarik anunya. Baik, next I'm inviting some other questions. Just say yes. Baik, ini saya berada di belakang sana. Sama Mas Anu, Mas. Silakan. Ini Mas Tarut, ini dulu, ini depan dulu Mbak. Silakan, silakan.
Saya bertanya pakai bahasa Indonesia ya?
Ya, boleh.
Perkenalkan, saya Iza. Pertemuan saya dengan Swarse itu juga sebenarnya dari buku yang terlupakan itu pertama kali, kan di situ ada salah satu penulis yang membaca karya Manusia Merdeka juga. Sebenarnya saya tanyakan juga cukup pribadi. Saya penasaran kenapa Swarse itu memilih jalan lewat pendidikan, sedangkan Swarni kan kita tahu dengan istri sedar kemudian di Kongres Perempuan. Sebenarnya apa yang melatar belakangi Swarse ini memilih jalan yang agak sedikit berbeda? Kemudian ketika membaca di ulasan itu, yang lagi-lagi ini masalah personal sebenarnya, saya tertarik kenapa Swarse saat itu sebenarnya cukup vokal mengkritisi Pak Sugondo. Kan ya, Bu Swarse masih mengatakan kalau Pak Sugondo itu bagaimanapun punya ego maskulin, begitu kan. Ya, beberapa kali mereka punya pertentangan pendidikan, pertentangan pemikiran gitu. Dan di masa itu beliau sudah berani, saya belum baca Manusia Merdeka, cuman dari ulasan itu kan memang sepertinya itu ya curahan hati beliau ya, tapi dengan nama yang lain, Sulastri dan siapa, saya lupa tokoh satunya di situ. Iya, sebenarnya kira-kira bagaimana alat pikiran Gus Warsi sehingga punya keberanian mengungkap aspek pribadi melalui sebuah karya, kemudian dengan jalan yang berbeda dengan saudaranya. Kira-kira dari ini kan kebetulan bertemu dengan orang-orang terdekat beliau gitu. Ya, terima kasih.
First, why Suwarsi took a different path from Suwari? Suwari was connected in the organization's movement, but Suwarsi took a more soft perjuangan.
As a teacher.
Through education, through literary works. Okay? And secondly, what do you think why Suwarsi was brave enough to criticize her husband to go in terms of political positions, says masculinity in the struggle of and it's very interesting. Yeah. Okay. But hold it, okay? That's the question. We are going to take some other questions. Okay, okay, please, Mbak, siapa, Mbak Moro.
Okay, good afternoon. I'm Astrid Reza. I'm representing UAS, Ruang Arsip dan Sejarah Perempuan. I study in UGM for my undergraduate long time ago. Now I'm a master student in kajian budaya in AMB. I'm working on I found very similarity on working on women's archives, especially family archive. I'm working on my own family archive, and also because I come also from Bogor and I'm mixed Japanese, Sudanese, and Chinese, I could totally relate with the context of the period of Suwarsi, and also as a writer, as a storyteller, I think what is important when we are dealing with especially women archives, there's no actually there's no emotional boundaries in diving in an archives. That's my experience. Now I'm working on places of setting a Mia Bustam biography, and I found what is very interesting with women of this era, they have a certain method of observations in their notes taking. I'm curious whether Suwarsi also have diary archives, aside from the letters and also the literary works. I read Mariati, which is very interesting. It was about all these collections of stories when she was a teenager in Bogor, which I could relate the setting in a different time. And also the people that she was retelling. One of them is also her sister, Suwan, when she was very active in Jogjava, but Suwarsi, as a little sister, look up at Suwarsi. So I think working with women in archives, we need a certain perspective that women at this era has this discipline of writing everything, which create another nuance in history, which you cannot find them in the male diaries or notes, which we always miss, I think. And also, I'm very interested with the unpublished works of Suwarsi, because I think it's still happening now in our literary community, of course, that women's perspectives are deemed too personal, too emotional, unimportant, and the editor or like literary figures always deem like Rukia's work was like, oh, this is too emotional, this is too dayu, which is not worth of publishing. We also have to see the politics of publications for women's writers, which are still happening today, totally happening. But when we find and we go back and dig our own archives of our predecessors, we found these very interesting things happening that goes beyond the age, at the era of colonialism, and this world today are experiencing actually the regression. So the words of Suwarsi, I'm looking for this to be to be a book, to be reinterpreted, to be an exhibition, which are being done by the young people on Rukia's work. And I found also the overwhelming, I'm working on the Mia Bustam archives, diaries, memoir, which are never read seriously by scholars. It's published, but nobody is reading it, nobody is analyzing it, which is disturbing for me as a scholar, with the lack of that perspective.
I think she will very good. She should be very good at it.
Yeah, and I mean, I heard about the Azuarzi archives, of course, and I'm really into this actually the diaries of women, because we found that different nuance, and they wrote very detailed about everything, which we should not deem it as an unimportant archive. I think we have to have that attitude first in the beginning, you know. And also, like, we are working in Ruas of making these periodizations of women history and also movement, and I'm looking like that early stage of Sudanese women that is always being marginalized by history. Geng Sunda, I always see it. Ini ada Geng Sunda nih. Bogor, Cianjur, Bandung, Garut, Malasminingrat to Dewi Sartika. It's not always Kartini. There's people in Manado, also in Padang, different places that we can dig. And I think as a history student, we have to do that as a young people, as a scholar in this university. We have a compulsory moral, you know, to dig that archives. And I think the young people of today have this luxury of having access, because it was very difficult. I mean, even for me as a scholar 10 years, 15 years ago in UKM, it was very difficult to get archives like this.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. This is a good point. The important it is to study in detail writings of female activists, ethnicities. And she's particularly wondering whether you find sort of biographical personal archives of Swazi. Okay.
No.
But hold on, okay? We still have moment. One more person will we're going to take another question from this.
Okay, thank you. I'm Ahmad from History Department. As we know, Suwarsi is a polyglot. He can Dutch, Sundanese, and English, German, and France. I have a question. What makes she like to learn so many languages? And then, is there have any script or literature or article is was writing in Germany or French? So, thank you.
Even the last point, right?
Yes.
Yes, whether you Swazi was polyglot. She was polyglot. She spoke several languages, right? And we are wondering whether she also wrote a text in, for example, in German or in French.
Yeah. No.
Now, tell me if she was not.
No, rarely. She didn't write stories in different languages. She only wrote Sudanese, Dutch, and Indonesian. But Indonesian, writing in Indonesian was very difficult for her because it was a kind of new language, and that is it is exactly what she said in one of the interviews. She said it is she even you can see that. I found that she was writing some stories first in Dutch, and then she translated it into Indonesian. But she had a lot of problems with the translation. But that she spoke, that she could speak also French, German, and English was not so strange, because that is what you learn in school at that time. she was in the Mulo, and at that time you learned all those languages. And because Holland is a country at the seaside, and that means with a lot of international contacts. So that is still what we do in school, is that we learn, you have to learn at least three languages, foreign languages. So she did it. But that is, we had some more
questions
before.
Yes, you answer the other questions.
To go back to the I said very short, no. there are no diaries. But as I say, you can, her stories, they are quite often the key to her personal life. And I couldn't talk about all the details today, but if you start reading very well a lot of stories, you'll find a lot of her own experiences about what it is to be married, what is the relation between a man and a woman. And besides that, what I also found out, you have to don't forget that she has a Sudanese Chinese background, but she was married to a Japanese man who belonged to the Japanese level of noble or level. It's interesting that although he was very, very modern that way, he wrote an article in which he explained that it was not good that, for instance, at the time you had a regent, and the regent was a title that you could, that was an heritage from father to son, and on and on and on. And he wrote an article that it was crazy to do that, because if you have to become a regent, you have, in the first time, you have skills to do that, and not the background of your family. That is, but there was, if you can learn something about marriage at the time, it's in her stories.
And the first two questions?
It's a story. We have to go back in time. Can you help me a little bit? What was it? Can you repeat
it? The first two questions was, why Suwarsi was taking different blood from Suwarsi, taking different blood from Suwarsi?
Yeah. That is very very obvious. She and her husband were living with an ideal to educate the people. And that means that they didn't become rich. They were very. You can read it in Manusha Papas. They were they had to struggle for to survive. It was always difficult with the school. There was no money and all these things. But they had the feeling, we have to do this. And at the end, you see that they had a lot of trouble. But at the same moment, you see, and maybe you remember the picture of Duperon and his wife with Suwarsi and Abdurrahman Prigodingo, you see that it is a completely different setting. They very well dressed, and because he was working for the Dutch, for the colonial government, and that is something that they didn't like. They say what are they doing with the ideals? They are dealing with the, I shouldn't say the enemy, but they are dealing with the colonial government. And after all, later on, after 1940, they had to do that too, because they had to survive. But at that time, there came a separation, and that was, you can feel that also, because in the end of Buiten het Gareel, you see that they need the help of her sister and her husband. And that is something that, in fact, they didn't like. There you see that the separation starts. You see it also the career. Later on, their life is not, they don't have a career after after the entire. Sugondo became was in the government. He was a minister several months, and after that, there happened nothing very much anymore. But the Pringodigdo family, they had a career. There was ambassadors. They have a complete different family, and that is they have a better certain feeling that they were more. Following the career, they were more following their ideals. And that's there you see the separation. They grow apart from each other.
Okay.
Is it?
Yeah. You want to that?
Yeah.
Hearing now? Yes.
And that was another question.
Yeah.
You have the second question.
Why was brave enough to criticize Sugondo, is it? In what sense?
Yes,
you see. Dalam hal apa? Saksikan
tindak punya dari pengungkapan yang mereka punya perbedaan pemikiran termasuk mereka
I think it's clear that the question is clear. I think why was she brave enough to
criticize her husband? They have some difference in perspective about.
Yes, I have two answers. First answer, ask my wife. she is, I might say, she's almost the same. That means she is also very powerful, and that's what I like. It is, it is always nice when you have somebody next to you who is not afraid to give her opinion, although it's not always nice. And that keeps each other sharp. But different is it to do that in a novel. And what she is doing in a novel is that in every novel you see that I don't know how you call it in English, but if I translated the word in Dutch, I should say that it's a key novel. That means all the persons really exist, but they have in the book a different name. So that means if you read a story, and if you don't know about who she is talking, you don't recognize her. So he is the person of Sugondo is hidden, in fact. And of course, the book is fiction based on the truth, but you can feel there must be a basic feeling, and that is. Yeah, that is why. Right. And she is, as I tell you, it must have been somebody with power. She's not afraid to give her opinion. As I said, she hasn't. She. I think there is also a difference between the Sudanese world, the Japanese world, and the Chinese world. So that all those influences she has in her, and besides that. If you go, if I read the stories about her father, he was also a very, very, very expressive person. He was not really common. He was a very good storyteller, but he was also somebody who was very strict. So he didn't dare to give his opinion.
Okay. Thank you. Time is about 5 minutes now. Is there any question? No? Okay. Hans, thank you very much for the very nice talk and inspiring talk.
I hope.
And actually, people are waiting for the whole story about Swazi.
Yeah,
me
too.
Yeah. Okay. And from now here, maybe we know Swazi only from the novel Manusia Bebas by the Karel. But Mas Tamin was the last week, there was an exhibition showing 10 forgotten female activists, and one of them was Swazi, Jo Buspito. So there is now growing attention here in terms of historiography and also in terms of the constructions of these people. Okay? And I know, as I told you, in Salatiga, in Satya Wacana, Salatiga, there was a course that makes use Manusia Bebas as a compulsory reading, and the students are asked to reconceptualize the story in it in different forms. So some of them do that by making paintings and so on based on the story of Biden and Karel. So it's very interesting way of representing history. Okay? And your book, the coming book, is very much awaited. Okay? And hopefully in 1 year time, when you come back here, then you will represent a book. Or maybe 1 year or more, I don't know. Maybe less than 1 year.
More time.
Okay.
The more I read, the more I have the feeling that the story has to be written.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. And last but not least, Mas Wahid, Pak Abdul Wahid, sebagai Pak Depaten, akan menetapkan dua penerima Nobel Prize. Pak Wahid, silakan.
Bagus tanggung jawab itu toh. Karena ditodong bagus untuk memilih dua, jadi saya memutuskan untuk mengundinya saja. Karena bagi saya tidak ada pertanyaan yang baik ataupun jelek, semua pertanyaan bagus. Jadi akan sangat susah sekali menilai berdasarkan kualitas pertanyaan. Jadi semua pertanyaan saya anggap bagus. Dan oleh karena itu saya sudah membuat kertas undian. So there are 6 names in Hans. We have to pick up 2 of them as a recipient of the books, as a door prize. So I think you have to choose one of them, and then I will choose another.
Okay.
And read it loud. Sudah itu diambil satu, yang lainnya masih ada 5. Masih ada 5 ya. Pak Agus sebagai notaris.
Oh, benar.
Saya ambil juga satu, sudah. Hans, please read it. Who is in it?
I hope I can do it well. It is Ahmad.
Ahmad Mahathir. Selamat. Kemudian penerima yang kedua, Andi, betul? Yang kedua itu?
Nadi.
Nadi, oke. Maaf, ini hanya kebetulan ya, tidak bermaksud memilih laki-laki semua. By chance kayak gitu. Ya silakan Mas Adi, Mas Ahmad untuk maju ke depan. Bu Dewi, monggo silakan untuk mempersembahkan buku kepada dua yang beruntung pakai ini. Yang lain juga pasti beruntung karena sudah ada kata Pak Agus di fotokopi. Terima kasih Bu Dewi, terima kasih semuanya. Thanks again Hans for your talk. Pak Agus, monggo ditutup.
Terima kasih Hans, thank you very much. Kita beri tepuk tangan untuk juga terima kasih untuk kedatangan pada hari ini. Tadi Pak Wahid sudah menyampaikan di awal bahwa dalam waktu 2 minggu akan ada Frank Mullen dalam acara yang kurang lebih sama, yang akan bicara mengenai pengalaman dia di detik-detik terakhir mundurnya Soeharto di Istana Negara. Oke. Jadi Frank Mullen akan bicara mengenai itu. Silakan datang 2 minggu lagi dan semoga ada double press lagi ya Pak Wajah. Pokoknya ada double press apapun ya, nanti Pak Wajah akan menyediakan. Terima kasih, sekian, selamat siang, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.